All right, so Unit 5, Module 27, Irrigation and Pest Control Methods. Our learning procedures, or our learning goals today, are describe the source of locations of water used for irrigation, explain the different types of irrigation, describe how irrigation can cause water logging, channelization, and aquifer depletion, and describe pesticide resistance and the impacts of genetic engineering on crops. Okay, so our first one, groundwater and surface water are used for irrigation. You probably already knew that if you've never worked in a garden, period. Okay, agriculture is the largest use for water worldwide, with 70% of water being used for irrigation. Groundwater is stored in the pore spaces within the permeable layer of rock and sediment, similar to a sponge, known as an aquifer. So if you look at a sponge and you soak up water, that's what it looks like for the permeable layers of a rock, and that is known as an aquifer. Okay, aquifers that allow water to easily flow are called unconfined aquifers. So there's not really a contained part of it. They're just hanging out there and they're going and leaving as they please. Aquifers are surrounded by impermeable rock or clay, are called confined aquifers. So the way I like to think about that is like, it would be like an underwater pond. Right, so it's surrounded by clay, which we know is not very permeable for water, and so it just kind of sits there. Okay, the uppermost level of aquifers is known as the water table. Okay, if you've ever heard somebody say, oh, we hit the water table, or if you watch any of those like gold mining shows on Discovery, that's kind of what they're talking about. Here's a good image of it. So your water table would be, this kind of as this image shows. So this is an unconfined aquifer. And the reason why is because it has water flowing into it from this little creek or river, and it's gonna flow out. And then a confined aquifer is like here, doesn't have a lot of water coming into it most of the time, and its leaving passage is very narrow. So you get a lot of water just sitting there for a very long time. Whereas an unconfined water is moving much more rapidly in and out. Okay. So as precipitation percolates to the soil, it passes into the groundwater known as a groundwater recharge. Water can percolate up to ground surface known as springs. Some confined aquifers can be drilled into and gather water at an artesian well. And wells, water in wells can take 10,000 to 20,000 years to recharge. So looking at this right here again, so the recharge spot for this confined aquifer, since it's underneath another layer that's impermeable, it's only going to have like this one opening where rain or snow or anything else like that's going to fall into and put water back into that area. Whereas the unconfined aquifer, it's going to have this area right here that's coming into it, but also any water that seeps into the ground and into the aquifer is going to recharge it. And so it's not going to take quite as long. And then we have two different types of well systems. So have you ever heard like, I'm on well water? Okay, that's pretty common here in Missouri, especially in rural areas where the public water may not go. So what that is they've drilled down into aquifer or groundwater, or I'm sure people call it other things. Okay, they've dug it down. And usually if there's not a lot of pressure on it, you'll have a pump at the bottom of it, and that's what brings the water to their house. And a lot of times those people have very hard water. You can tell because they go through coffee machines or washers really quickly, that kind of stuff, because it has a lot of sediment in it from sitting on top of the rock. And then the other type of well we have is the flowing artesian well. And that has a lot of pressure to it, so we call it like a spring. And so if you've ever been to like Bennett Springs in Lebanon, Missouri, that's spring fed. So it's really cold because it's down below the frost layer. So the temperature doesn't really change. It's always kind of cold. Right? And that has a lot of pressure, so you wouldn't need a well or a pump. You need a lot of valves to kind of check it off. Okay, so that's the difference between the two wells. Okay, so water is a resource that's limited, but does cycle through. So there is a finite amount of water, and we use it like it is not, we use it like it's just going to be there forever, and it may not be. Okay, so overuse of water prevents it from recycling fast enough to replenish, so efforts are focused on water conservation. The total daily per capita use of fresh water for a country for the world is known as the water footprint. So you've heard of your eco footprint or your carbon footprint. There's a water footprint as well. In the U.S., 1/3 of fresh water is used for irrigation. And we know that 70% of the water in the world is used for agriculture, so that makes sense. Okay. And other large uses of water include for livestock. So not just growing crops, but also watering your cattle and your pigs and your chickens. So water withdrawn per inhabitant. So that's just a nice graphic to kind of show you how much water we are using. As you can see, like, water is not a problem here in the United States. We use a lot of it. Okay. All right, there are four major types of irrigation. And so the first one is furrow irrigation. Trenches or furrows are filled with water next to the crops. It's not super efficient. It has a 33% water loss, so not all the water that you put in these furrows or troughs are going to make it to your crops, so it's just going to evaporate. Okay, then we have our flood irrigation. So flood irrigation, the entire field is flooded with water, and so that loses a little bit less water. It's a little bit more efficient. You only lose 20% water loss. And so if you've ever seen those, like, cranberry juice commercials where it's like these farmers standing in a field and their waders and that kind of stuff, that's what it's talking about. And so cranberries typically grow with flood irrigation. And you only want to use that for certain types of fruits and vegetables. It doesn't work for everything. Like, you wouldn't do that for potatoes. Right? Huh? No, grapes like dry environments. Yeah. Then you have spray irrigation. So water is pumped and sprayed over crops through nozzles. Okay, if you've ever driven on Highway 63 to Columbia, you can see on those over by the ball fields, they have I think it's a turf or a sod farm, and you can see those big arms, and they rotate, and if you catch them in the summertime, they'll be spraying water, just like a sprinkler does in your yard. Okay, and then drip irrigation, so slowly dripping water through your hoses directly near plants, roots. Okay, we'll take a look at what that looks like a little bit more tomorrow. But that's the most efficient as far as water loss goes. But it's not the most commonly used, and I wonder if you can think of why.
Which is not the most commonly used?
The drip irrigation.
It's too little water, and we need big water to fuel how many crops they have. Crops that you
have. Maybe. Might be some other reasons we look at it tomorrow. That's a good guess, though. Okay. So we talked about waterlogging yesterday, or a couple days ago. So waterlogging is when something becomes completely saturated in water. Like, if you ever walk through a body of water with your shoes on and you've been doing it for a while, you take them out and they're just like filled with water. Or when you leave a sponge in the sink and you bring it up and it's just like pouring water out, you can't hold any more water. That's water logging. Okay, so plant roots extend into A horizon and B horizon, and when there's high amounts of irrigation, those roots are flooded. And so if you've ever seen like little gnats flying around like a flower pot, that usually means that it's going through root rot, and that happens because there's too much water there, and so the roots can't breathe, and so they are decomposing in your flower pot, so quit watering it as much, okay? This kind of setup, so you usually on flower pots will want like a well-draining pot, so you usually will have like a hole at the bottom of it, and so the hole at the bottom of it we'll let the water seep out because you don't want it to sit on the soil because then your roots are going to go bad. But this kind of stuff, what'll happen is it'll use capillary action to get up to the roots. Remember, capillary action is water seeking to itself and seeking to other things like in your straw. And so it'll go through these pores and get up to the roots that way. Whereas here, the roots don't have the choice on whether to take that water next to it or not. They're just surrounded by it. Okay, when crops become waterlogged, another problem that occurs is salinization. So we talked about how that is the water evaporates and it leaves behind the salts and the minerals, and it kind of just dries things out. Large amount of water evaporate and leave behind salts, which can be toxic or impede plant growth. Okay, aquifers can become depleted due to overuse from different sources. I think we'll look at an image of that in a minute. Okay, so this image is in your textbook, and I think it does a little bit better job there with the excerpt that's by it. So this is the water level changes in feet in these different areas. And so you can see, like parts of Texas, the water level in this lake has dropped like more than 150 feet in, you know, in the water. And so you can see like we're just using a lot of it, and we're using a lot of it for what do you think? Growing crops, right? Or Texas isn't really known for growing crops, but for what? Cattle, right? Is that what you're going to say? Yeah. Same thing with Colorado, Oklahoma, Kansas, all those things, they're used for livestock more than probably actual plants, right? Okay. So aquifer depletion is this image right here. This is called the Kona Depression. And so the Kona Depression happens when the water is being used more than how it's being replenished. So heavy pumping, before heavy pumping, everybody on this street has access to water because their wells are digging deep enough, and then the farm wells also digging deep enough. But if they have heavy pumping without a lot of recharging, so water getting back into the system, you're going to have the kind of depression, and the only person who's going to have water is the person who dug their well the deepest, right? So that's the kind of depression. It's because it's not being replenished or recharged enough. Okay, so now we're into pesticides. So identify the advantages and consequences of pest control methods. Pesticides are meant to reduce pests, but also can cause adverse consequences. So further groups of pesticides include the big four. So fungicide, meant to target fungus. Rodenticide, meant to specifically target rodents, okay? Persistent pesticides are that remain in the environment for decades. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. And the non-persistent pesticides are ones that are meant to break down rapidly in weeks or months, but may be applied more often. So the example we talked about was like Roundup, and Ms. Collins' dad was in that because he used Roundup to kill weeds or do landscaping, whatever he was doing, and now he has some cancer stuff. Okay. As an alternative to pesticides to be discussed further is integrated pest management to minimize pest inputs. So we'll talk about this, but that's pretty interesting, and I think that if you like biology at all, you'll find integrated pest management very fascinating. It talks about how we can use certain bugs or plants and that kind of stuff to keep other things away. And so instead of using the harsh chemicals, that would be helpful. Jay, do you have a question?
Well, I was just going to ask, what would be, because it sounds like with persistent pesticides that there would be a negative effect.
With persistent pesticides?
Water pollution is one of them.
Yeah, so yeah, water pollution, probably because it's going to have runoff, right, into fields. Good. So back in the Vietnam War, they dropped Agent Orange on people, and that's a pretty harsh chemical that's causing cancer and stuff like that, and it's still causing issues. And so you consider that maybe like a persistent pesticide. It just has a long-lasting effect, and so it's still affecting people in Vietnam like today. Okay, so overuse of pesticides can lead to pesticide resistance, a trait that certain individuals' pests develop when they are exposed to a pesticide and survive passing on traits and aiding in surviving of the pesticide. This leads to the application of more stronger pesticides known as the pesticide treadmill. Okay, so the way it starts is you plant your crops, you notice you have pests, you put some pesticides on it. One of those pests has a mutation that allows it to not be susceptible to the pesticide effects. And then just like natural selection, okay, has the better genes to survive, reproduces, and then you have more pests that are pesticide resistant, and then you have to try apply a different, stronger pesticide, right? And then somebody grows a mutation of that, and eventually you're just like burning everything with fire because that's the only way to kill your pests. That's the pesticide treadmill. Okay, on our way to reduce pesticides, is an increase in GMOs, or genetically modified organisms. So again, a lot of people think GMOs are bad for you, which there's not really any definite report or research that confirms that. And also, a genetically modified organism, you're eating them every day. You don't have a choice. Okay, so if I'm a cattle farmer, do I want to breed my two littlest cows together, or am I going to breed my two biggest cows together? My two biggest cows together, right? Because I want them to be big. That's modifying what they were going to do originally, right? So in a field or in nature or in the wild, they might pick because of a different trait, but I am telling them what trait they're going to be bred for. Same thing with corn or anything else. Yeah. Naturally, yeah. Yep. And so GMOs make sense because we need crops that are going to feed everybody. If you have something to add to that.
Yeah, I'm just, why would farmers use more natural methods instead? Like, using lady bugs or introducing other, insects that eat those bugs, like wasps and things.
Yeah, good question. So why don't we, as farmers, use those integrated pest management systems? We'll get into that a little bit later in the unit, but that's a good question. So the main reason is money. You can't really control ladybugs very well, or wasps. But I can make sure every square inch of my field gets sprayed with this chemical. Yeah, good question. Okay, so strains of crops can be modified to release toxins to pests so that way they don't eat the crop. Other methods can be used to include making the crop herbicide tolerant so the crop can continue to be sprayed without affecting the herbicide. This won't reduce the use of pesticides, but it can save more crops. Okay. So the whole goal, if I'm a farmer, is to try to make the most money, right? That's the whole goal of anybody in life most of the time. So the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to secure my bets. I'm going to modify organisms to give me the most output, right? If I can have a corn stalk that grows 10 bushes of corn as opposed to one, I'm going to choose the 10. Like, that's just makes sense, right? Okay, so the way I do that is GMOs, and then I want to make sure the bugs aren't eating my crops, so I'm using pesticides. It's all just a cycle because we're trying to make money, right? Okay, and that is your month 27.